You know, I will never forget the day that I stood in a receiving line at the American Embassy in Paris, France, about to shake the hand of the future President of the United States of America. That was a real wow moment, you know, the kind where you kind of pinch yourself and go, is this really happening to me? I know y'all have had moments like that, haven't you? A wow moment, a real wow moment. Well, aside from being a real wow moment, for me it was also a mile marker. A mile marker in this journey of change that we call life. Because if you roll the tape back just a few more years, you'll see that same girl standing in a welfare line at my local bank, making my way up to the cashier's cage that had a big sign over it that said, food stamps only. With people I knew in my hometown looking at me and thinking to myself, can I belong in a place like this? What would my parents think if they saw me here? Well, I know what you're thinking. So she's moved a lot. And she's had some hard times. But what does she really know about change? What does she know about what's going on in my life? What does she know about the changes that I'm going through? Well, of course, I can't know about everything in your life. But I do know this, that change comes to everyone's life. If you're not in the middle of a change, you're about to go into one, or you're just coming out of one, and isn't that the way life is? And the other thing that I know about change is a universal truth, and that is that change will change you. The question is, how? Will it make you bitter, or will it make you better? Let me tell you a story. You know, I was standing in that welfare line, and the reason I was in that welfare line was because one day, after my husband, who had been unfaithful over and over again, and I had reconciled, I forgave him, and we were doing, I thought, okay, a woman appeared on my doorstep to tell me that I needed to leave. And he agreed. And I found myself literally out in the snow with two small children, and nowhere to go. Well, a friend that I had saw me through the immediate crisis, and then little by little, I got my feet back underneath me, and I started again. I used the two skills I had. I knew how to type, and I knew how to teach dancing. So I worked as a GS4 clerk typist in the typing pool, and
I hated that job.
It paid me, and it had benefits, and then I taught dancing. And I loved teaching dancing. I loved my students. And little by little, I was able to get back up on my feet again. And then, a very interesting thing happened. My son was old enough to start going to kindergarten. Now, I had a real handle on the fact that I was a single woman. But I had really not focused on the fact that I was a single parent. Until the day when I bought all of his school supplies, that big long list they give you when they start kindergarten, you may gotta buy this and that, da, 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 da. I bought all that stuff and I had it on the table. And there was a light that hung above that table and it shone down on all that stuff. And I walked by there, I saw that bright blue tissue box, and I saw his little crayons, and it really hit me. I am a single parent. But you know, when I was growing up, my sister's here today, she can verify this. When I was growing up, we went to church every single Sunday. But when I left for college, that was not the pattern of my life. And it certainly was not my habit to pray. But that night, with an uncertain future ahead of me, and the reality that I had children to raise on my own, I did something I haven't done in a very long time. I knelt down next to my bed, and I prayed. Do any of you know that old-timey song, I Believe? You know, part of it goes, I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows. You've heard that song, haven't you? It's kind of an old one. Well, there's another lyric in that song that says, I believe above the storm, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that somewhere, in the great somewhere, someone in the great somewhere, hears every word. And I believe that too. Because that night, I knelt down and I prayed, and the words came out in big, heavy sobs. And then I crawled into bed, and I cried myself to sleep. I got up in the morning, and everything was the same. Because that's how life is. But changes were taking place. Changes that I wasn't even really aware of. The first thing that happened was that God shifted my focus from men to career. And the next thing I knew, my little dancing school was so successful I could leave that terrible, terrible corporate job and do nothing but teach dancing. And then I had architectural plans in my hand, and I was about to build my own dancing school. You know, that night that I prayed, one of the things I said was, Lord, would you send me someone to love who would love me back and help me raise my children? Nothing happened. Nothing happened.
Nothing happened.
And then, as I was registering all of my students for dancing school, which was in late August, early September, I kept getting these messages from this Lieutenant Commander, William B. Hunt. Well, I thought he was one of the fellows from over on the base that wanted the kids to come dance at the hospital, because they would do that from time to time to just cheer up the troops. And so I didn't answer his calls. I just talked to my mommies. I don't mind my mommies, because my mommies had kids, and they would register for class. Well, one night he got through after answering service was over. And he said that he knew the father of one of my students, that he lived down the street, and that we should get together. Oh, really? I said, I'm very tired. I don't think that's a good idea. He said, I'll be right over. And he hung up. Well, I thought by the time he gets there, I'm going to give it to him. Oh, thanks. I opened that door, and I have to tell you, between the moment I first saw Bill and the time I said hello, I knew that that was the man I had prayed for. And it has been 33 years since then of a man I still call my handsome prince. And really, isn't that just a wonderful story? You know, it's just a wonderful, doesn't you love stories like that? Happy ending, handsome prince. Can't you see them sailing off into the sunset? The music swelling when you wish upon a star. Not exactly. Didn't quite go like that. Can anybody here tell me if they know what the second highest cause of stress in the United States of America is after the death of a spouse? Does anybody know?
Divorce.
No?
Moving.
Moving. That's exactly right. A sailor, you know. It is moving. And do you know why? It's because moving brings about change in absolutely every area of your life. Physically, it'll leave you black and blue and sore in places you never imagined. Mentally, it'll turn you into a checklist insomniac. Emotionally, it'll take you on a roller coaster ride that makes Carowinds look like the teacup ride in a Disney World. Highest of highs, lowest of lows. And spiritually, it can flip you on the backside of the desert faster than you can say in quick repair and cactus. And so with all that kind of change in your life, that's where I began. My first move with Bill, from Newport, Rhode Island to Honolulu, Hawaii, in the middle of a blizzard. Really and truly. So here I was, a brand new bride, a brand new military wife, and a brand new stepmom. And we decided we'd start our trek cross country where we were going to ship the car with a trip to Disney World. So we have all the kids in the car and our collie, and we drive down to Florida. The first little inkling that I had, things were not right, was when we went across the Newport Bridge. And I went, oh, what have I done? But I just smiled and kept going, and we got down to Florida. And I did okay, until we got to It's a Small World After All. You know, they have all those little dolls, and they're so cute, and they have their costumes. And they sing, it's a small world after all. You know that. there. That reminded me of all my dancing school kids.
Oh.
In their little costumes. Yeah, singing. And I just lost it. I started to cry. I cried all the way through Disney World, right through to Alabama. And Bill had finally had it. He said, okay, sweetie, come with me. Stepped outside the restaurant, put his hands on my shoulders, and he said to me, listen, if you're that much in love with Newport, Rhode Island, honey, maybe you ought to go back. Is that what you want? You know, sometimes you need just a little bit of tough love to get you straightened out. And I looked at him and I said, yes, that is exactly what I want, because that is what I wanted. I did want to go back, but with him, and have everything be the way it was while we were dating and while we were newlyweds, and I still had my dancing school and my life just the way I knew it and everything. And everything was so different and so many big unknowns ahead. And I just wanted to go back. And he said to me, well, sweetheart, that ain't gonna happen. I have orders to Honolulu, Hawaii. Let's get going. And so I knew right there, without anybody giving me a book about 7 steps to happiness, that I needed an attitude change on the spot. And so I did. Just got a hold of myself and I said, okay. And we went on. Now, you know, that's real easy to say. Get a new attitude. Just, you know, you need an attitude adjustment. Just get a hold of yourself and get on. So how do you do that? How do you get a new attitude? Well, I've thought of a couple of things. And they are that you look back. You look forward. You look around. You learn to laugh. And you look up. Now, when I say you look back, what I mean by that is, when you have a lot of change going on in your life and you have to do something about it, you look back and you think about all the things that have happened to you and you concentrate on the things that were the good things. That's the first thing you do. Count your many blessings, count them one by one. And it is amazing how you will be able to see how much you have accomplished already, how far you've already come, all the good things that have already happened, and focus on those. But sometimes when you look back, I know you look back and you think about failures. And we all have those, don't we? Anybody in here perfect? Would you raise your hand? I'm looking for that perfect. There is no such thing as a perfect person, is there? There's just no such thing as perfect people. We all make mistakes. We all have failures. We all have things in our lives that we'd like to look back and change, don't we? But you know what? We can. Anybody else in here got a time machine? No. Nobody's perfect. Nobody has a time machine. So what do you do with those failures? Well, you look at them this way. You may have failed, but you are not a failure. And failure is not a permanent condition. Pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and think about failure as failing forward. And then sometimes when you look back, you think about the horrible things that happened to you. Things that you had no control over. Things from your past that, if you could change, not only would you change, but you would never allow it to happen to anyone else. And when those things are a part of your life, you have another choice that you can make. And that is the choice to forgive. Now, I'm not talking about forgiveness that says, oh, everything that's happened to me is okay. It's all right. No, it's not all right. You were hurt, and that is not all right. And it's not the kind of forgiveness that says, well, I'm going to forgive them, and I'm just going to lay down and be a doormat and let them keep doing to me the things that they have done that hurt me. No, that's not forgiveness either. But like a good attitude, forgiveness is a choice. And you can choose to forgive, even when you don't feel like it. What you do is make the choice. You forgive. And then eventually your feelings will catch up to your choice to forgive. But it doesn't happen overnight. It's not a one-time thing. It's a process, and it's something that goes on over and over and over again. Sometimes you have to forgive them the moment they hurt you.